Good evening, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. This is Pastor Ingram once again, and we have a very interesting topic that we're going to discuss this morning. I'm sorry, this morning time. I'm waking up. God is in the blessing business, but today we're going to talk about Passover. And Passover is one of the most, is the most important feast day of all of them, I believe. All of them are very important, but we're going to talk about Passover because that was the day that God ordained that his people leave Egypt out of slavery. And they had been in slavery for 430 years, and God sent a prophet by the name of Moses to deliver the Hebrews from Egyptian bondage. And God gave them instructions. You know, these feast days, they are holy days. I thank God for my panel here, Brother Mario and First Lady. Amen. They're here. They're. I want to call them understudy, but they know just about as much as I do. Amen. And that's where it's supposed to be. You know, with the invention of the internet, man. You can caught up with me, man. You know. But anyway, we're celebrating these holy days. These are not holidays. They are holy days. The world call them holidays, but the Bible call them holy days. This is a day that we celebrate to honor God. God has seven feasts, and he wants to be honored. And when you honor God, God will bless you and your family. I think the church has missed it because the church that I grew up in, we all thought it was up under the law, and you don't need to do all that. But as I grew in my Christian walk, I found out that, hey, man, we need to do that. To learn the history and to learn what Passover is all about. It's about Jesus, amen. Yeshua. It's about him. It ain't about eating and drinking, but it's about him and his blood.
Amen. Right. Amen. And you know, every time that we take the Lord's Supper, whether we know it or not, that we're honoring the Passover. When that was stated in the Bible, when Jesus was with his disciples on that night before he was crucified, that was the Passover. And we take the Lord's Supper, and we just take it because we think it's a ritual and that we should do it. But that's in the remembrance of the death of the Lord Jesus Christ and leading up to his resurrection.
In the future, you know, so God has really been blessing. Like I said, the Passover is a blessed time.
It's a blessed time.
It's a time of sacrifice. It's a time of putting away sin. It's a time of recognizing our faults, not this person's faults, that person, but you look at the individual and fix the things that's wrong with the end of what yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's good. Look at yourself, you know. Passover is good that we look at ourselves and don't worry about other people because we all have faults. Sins, you know, and I think that during this time, now this is not what they call legalistic. A lot of people have taken this thing and tried to say that this is about salvation. No, it's not about salvation, but it is after you get saved, then you should come into the knowledge how to celebrate God's holy days. You know, people celebrate everything else. They celebrate Halloween and St. Patrick's Day and all that kind of stuff. Now we need to find out what God wants us to celebrate. Amen. Amen. And I'm not condemning people that do all that. I'm just telling you that God has a better way.
Yes.
And, Mario, would you go to Leviticus, the 23rd chapter, and read that? You know, I want to give you some word here. I don't want to just want you to think I'm talking off the top of my head. But we're going to the word in Leviticus, the 23rd chapter.
Can I get this real quick?
Go ahead. Right.
And this is in the book of Colossians.
Okay.
And this is the second chapter.
Real good.
And we'll go to 16. And it says in the scriptures, this is so people don't hold you to things and say you're going to go to hell if you don't and all this. You know, because it's a lot of things about this that we don't even understand.
Yes.
People haven't even got the fullness of. But in the scriptures, Colossians, second chapter in verse 16, it said, let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink, or in respect of an holy day, or of the new moon, or of the Sabbath day, which are a shadow of things to come, mm-hmm. but the body is of Christ.
Yes.
So Paul was letting us know in that particular passage and what was going on at that time. The Pharisees was the they were that they got a deal they called the Talmud.
Mm-hmm.
And the Talmud, they started adding all these extra laws and rules and things that was going on. And when you read further on in this passage and you get to verse 21 through 21-22, it'll tell you for the commandments of men, that's the problem. So what ended up happening, people start being so legalistic about it, they was putting people in hell that wasn't keeping it.
Yeah, that's right.
Oh, you wasn't doing this, you didn't do that during the Passover, you didn't do this. Oh, well, you lost, brother, it's over. Mm-hmm. Where God got his way and man got their way, but God's way is going be over everybody else.
Amen. Right. You know, some denominations have built their denomination on a day, on a Sabbath day. Mm-hmm. And that ain't what the New Testament church is about. You know, if the people in the Old Testament, they couldn't keep it. Uh-huh. So that's the reason why that God sent Yeshua, Jesus. Uh-huh. You know, not to destroy it, but to fulfill. Fulfill means take it to another level.
Yeah.
And like you said, Mario, they was adding to it and adding to it until it just become a man thing, not a God thing. So you have that in 23?
23, Leviticus chapter 23.
Yes, sir. Start the first verse, uh-huh.
Leviticus chapter 23 in the first verse, and it says, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, and say unto them, concerning the feast of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be a holy convocation, even these are my feasts.
Mm. Read a little bit more.
6 days shall work be done, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of rest and holy convocation. You shall do no servile work therein. It is the Sabbath of the Lord in all your dwellings. These are the feasts of the Lord, even holy convocations, which you shall proclaim in their season.
Okay, these are the feasts. Somebody said, well, that was up under the law. Baby, that was way before law. It was in creation, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was.
In the beginning. So God has always got a remedy, and these are days that should be celebrated. This, you can have fun. Have joy, man. This is not nothing. I've seen people keep the feast days. They all mad and the mouth all stuck out. You might as well forget it because it ain't going to do you no good.
Uh-huh.
It's supposed to be a delight.
Amen.
When you do something for God, it should be a delight.
Mm-hmm.
You know, some people, they some folk glad that they're having this virus because they don't want to go to church.
Uh-oh.
They delight standing home looking at TV. Oh, my God, help right now. No, I'm delighted because I can get in the presence of God's people because
amen.
I know that if God's people are praying, then there's help for me.
Yes, amen.
There's deliverance for me. Did you say everything you want to say?
I'm glad you said that because really a true Christian is up at this time. That they should not be in bed and just thinking that this is a time that they're going to relax and get some extra sleep. It's lots of word, not just us. It's lots of people on the internet and on Facebook and going forth with the word of God and read your Bibles and just spend some time in prayer at this time. God has us at home for a reason. It's a reason that we're at home. And I was looking here, it says, the death angel passed over their homes, sparing their firstborn.
Mm.
That was for the Hebrews. But, you know, the Egyptians, they lost their firstborn, the firstborn even of the cattle. You know, you look back at that had to be a dreadful time.
Oh,
that was pretty dreadful. And we've read that over the years. But that's the base of the Passover. Because the plagues that were sent, it just wasn't enough.
Mm-hmm.
But when they bothered the firstborn, that's what got the attention. And I find it ironic now that how the death angel through this coronavirus has visited many homes and many people.
Yeah.
And it's during this Passover. So it's so important that we recognize this time because that's a blessing. It's a blessing to celebrate and honor the Passover.
Yeah, something else. Oh, yeah. You know, I was trying. God is trying to get the New Testament church, the church of the day, to get in prayer and to get in keeping his days.
Mm-hmm.
Because we're going into a period of time where we're going in the ending of days. And you think the coronavirus is bad. You wait till the next one start coming.
Oh, boy.
You know, so God has always got a remedy. You know, one thing I like about the Lord, the Passover is symbolic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
In the Old Testament, Mario and First Lady, they took an unspotted lamb.
Yeah, they did.
an unspotted lamb. Mm-hmm. See, it's a symbol mm-hmm. of the lamb that's to come.
Yeah.
So when John seen Christ, our Passover, he said, behold, the Lamb of God that take away the what? Sin. That lamb couldn't take away sin. Uh-huh. That animal, he could cover it. Uh-huh. And you know what? When he got through making that sacrifice, the people went right back doing what they was doing. And when the priest went into the Holy of Holies and made, and you know one thing about that priest, he had to be right. Uh-huh. Because if he had been doing some atrocities and sin, then he dropped dead.
Yeah, that's right.
And they had bells on him. I guess you couldn't get no preachers in there. I know I wouldn't go in there.
Boy,
and when them bells stopped ringing, they drug him out and sent somebody else in there. Oh, God have mercy. See, God is merciful, isn't he?
Amen.
Yes, sir.
And you know, during that time of the Passover, it intertwines with unleavened bread. And the unleavened bread, it refers to the sin in our lives. Uh-huh. And during that time, we don't eat anything, and they refer it, to, it goes back to Scripture, those things that had leaven in it. And think about all the things that we eat and we enjoy. It's our comfort food, the unleavened, the things with leaven, like cakes and pies and cookies and those things that are delicious. But during that time, we refrain from that. What, 7 days?
7 days
we refrain from that. And you may think, oh, I can do that. But when you really get into it, it's very tempting because all those things should not even be in the home. But it refers to the sin. God's given us another chance to get the sin out of our life. And we all have sin in our lives. Mm-hmm. Ministers, the first ladies, the people in the church, we just have sin in our lives. Mm-hmm. And we continuously work on the sin in our lives on a daily basis. So this is the time during the unleavened bread that we'll also make that celebration as well.
Mm-hmm. You know, people say when they get saved, they talking about they don't sin no more. I know you're lying. The Bible says if you say you haven't sinned, you're a liar. You're a liar.
Yeah.
You know, I was brought up in a church where they said, you know, and you'd be brought up in a way till you be programmed to do the same thing folk do. You know, you get up and testify, say I'm saved, sanctified, no good and well. I wasn't living right. I was trying, though. At least I was trying in the ball game. But when certain things come up in my life, man, oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
You know. Go ahead, Mario.
Well, just looking at that unleavened bread, first thing he was talking about, you know, Passover is going into the unleavened bread. And the leaven being sin. And leaven causes people to be puffed up. If you ever, if a person understands how to cook, or those that have knowledge on cooking and baking, you know about how the leaven is. It don't take much yeast or leaven in the dough to make it rise.
Hmm.
And it's the same thing with sin today. We got to recognize where we are with sin today. Sin today, it starts with a small thing. You know, when they started doing same-sex marriages, it didn't start with just all of a sudden.
Mm-hmm.
It started a long time ago. Whenever you start crossing gender issues, when you start crossing boundaries, women and things for men, and you start crossing those things, then what happens is that little leaven is put, all it takes is a little bit, and then the devil takes it, run with it.
Yes, sir.
And he'll cause it to blow up into a bigger thing. That's why the word of God is a light to our feet and a lamp to our path. He's able to lead and guide us. Whenever we feel like we think we need to do something different, we check the word of God to see what he says, and whatever he says, we just fall back in line.
Yeah.
And that keeps us on that straight path. But that leaven, getting that leaven out, is some work.
It's work.
Yeah. You know, I think they said back in the days that with the Jews, when they would clean out their houses, they would go in with brooms and sweeping and looking for anything that had any kind of, they would clean their houses up. And that was symbolic of cleaning our house.
All right.
Cleaning temple bodies up. There was us taking time in meditation. We would stop and what we would say? We would say, well, Lord, help reveal to me the sin in my life.
Yes.
Do I hate my brother? Do I hate my sister? Do I hate my uncle, my father, my mother? Whatever the case. Am I stealing on the under? Some people stealing from work.
Oh, yeah.
Some people stealing from different things and stealing from people. But am I an adulterer? Am I an adulterer?
Yes.
Whichever way, a whoremonger, whichever way you want to look at it.
That's
right. You have to start to evaluate yourself and clean these things up.
Clean them up. Exactly. Clean them up.
Amen.
That's right. That's very good, Brother Mario. The Bible speaks about the word Passover. So God commanded his people to put blood after they killed. You know, it's hurting. But it was for the right thing. You know, they'd take a little young lamb and they'd raise that lamb, and then within a year they had to slaughter him.
Mm-hmm.
Oh my God. You know, you can get used to an animal, you know, and like them. But God tells him to go ahead and kill the animal, and then when you kill him, take his blood and sprinkle it over the door. Sprinkle it over the door. You know, blood is powerful, isn't it?
Yes, it is.
Because life is in the what, Mario?
Blood.
It's in the blood. They drain your blood out, you dead. So life is in the blood. That's why God had to use his own blood to redeem us from sin.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Because we were some contaminated people. Mm-hmm. And if we're not careful, we can still get contaminated. But thank God,
yes,
for the blood.
Thank God for the blood.
And he told him to sprinkle the blood on the doorpost. And when that death angel would come through the land and he'd look and he'd see that doorpost had blood on it, mm-hmm, he passed right over.
That's right.
That's why they sung a song, "When I See the Blood,
mm-hmm,
I Will Pass Over You." Ladies and gentlemen, we need the blood now.
Amen.
During this so-called season of the coronavirus, you need the blood.
Amen.
You need the blood. When you go in the grocery store, you know, Oklahoma's still being blessed because it hadn't been really contaminated like these other states. Mm-hmm. It was Mississippi, Georgia, and Arkansas and Oklahoma, they haven't been contaminated as much as these other people. I was looking on that map they had. So saints, keep praying.
Yeah. Amen.
The real people of God, keep praying.
Amen.
You know, it might be not as bad here in Oklahoma as they say it is. But anyway, he said that when I see the blood, that angel would pass over you.
Mm-hmm.
I want the blood over me, my house, and everything else.
Amen.
Did you ever think?
Yeah. And you know, from unleavened bread, we go into first fruits. And Christ is our first fruit.
First fruit.
And it happened, the first fruits is 3 days after we celebrate the Passover. And Jesus arose from the grave. He came out of the grave. And so we celebrate that, our first fruits. And that's part of the spring feast as well, because you have your Passover, and it intertwines with the unleavened bread. Then we go into the first fruit. Then we go into Pentecost, which is 50 days later, when Jesus promised the Holy Spirit would be our guide and our teacher, and would lead us in the right way. And the Holy Spirit is what we depend on. So all these feast days come together, and the Pentecost was the beginning of the church. That's how someone asked you, how did the church get started? Well, that was the beginning of the church. So it all makes sense. And you may say, man, what are they talking about this morning? It's in your Bible. We're reading from the Bible that you have at home. It's in your Bible. But you have to rightly divide the word of truth.
Yes, amen.
Amen. Amen. First they were saying about our first fruits, you know, Christ being the first, raised from the dead, the firstborn from the dead, raised from the dead. God raised him up.
Mm.
And that's real powerful there, because I don't know nobody else that ever got up from it. You know, I know our hope. And thought in my mind, like, you know, if we lose our loved ones, we want to see them again. But that's what the promise of Christ is all about, and salvation is about. It's about being able to meet up with your loved ones again, and those that are died in Christ, those that believe in God, and those that keep these days. So the first fruits is very powerful, because that tells me that God has got a plan for us. It's not death and the grave and then the earth and just later and rot. It's a life after death.
Mm-hmm.
And so him raising up from the dead, and God raising him up from the dead, gives hope. Mm-hmm. And that's what I look for, is the hope of Christ.
Yes.
And like I said, being first fruits going into Pentecost, mm-hmm, we have 50 days of prayer, seven Sabbaths up until the day of Pentecost.
Yes.
And in those seven Sabbaths, you know, when Christ was on the scene, they was actually acting out this whole scene. Once they got to the day of Pentecost, they had already been praying for 7 weeks in the church.
Uh-huh.
After that, they had been keeping this feast, and it was ordained that on the day of Pentecost, God would start his church. God would give his spirit to his people. And when he gave his spirit to his people, something miraculous happened that day. It was 120 of them.
120
praying in the place. And the Holy Spirit fell on them with fire.
Mind,
they all spoke in different tongues.
Uh-huh.
In different languages.
What, yes.
What was God doing? God was unraveling what he did from the beginning when he confused the Tower of Babel.
Uh-huh.
He took the languages, confused them, and caused the Satan's building to stop. Well, on the day of Pentecost, he began building the church. And what did he do? He had them to communicate with other people.
Uh-huh.
And so God is really doing a wonderful work. And we just look to these feast days for the knowledge in them,
uh-huh,
and different insight on what's going on.
Real good, real good. You know, since you're talking about the feast days, now, I've done some studies, and we did some studies about the Azusa Street Revival.
Uh-huh.
Started on Passover. Isn't that right?
Uh-huh.
It started during the Passover season. The greatest revival to ever hit America was the Azusa Street. And the Azusa Street run about 60 years, because by the time I got saved back in 68, 69, in that area, it was still going. And then they changed it from Azusa to Charismatic. But it's really the Azusa. That was so powerful. It went around the world 5-6 times. That was a powerful revival. People got baptized in the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues as a spirit. So we could look for another Pentecost, another great awakening in America. Mm-hmm. Hopefully the saints keep praying, we could have that. So it would happen in 1906, during the feast day season. And Seymour Williams, yeah. He was a Methodist preacher. Wasn't no Pentecost. And Bishop Charles Mason, he was a Baptist preacher. So that's the way revival used to happen. God get these people out of denominations because denominations ain't teaching nothing or weak. Uh-huh. And he had to pull people out of there. Just like he had to pull Apostle Paul out of Judaism. It got so messed up. So God had to have men and women, he pull them out to empower them to take this work on, the revival. Yeah, and so the Azusa Street went from, oh my goodness, that thing was so powerful. But go ahead, First Lady.
Yeah, I was thinking, and both of those were African-American men.
That's right.
Seymour Williams and Bishop Mason. They were African-American men. And so we're included in this too. You know, I hear a lot of ministers on television, and sometimes they'll mention the patriots in the past, and they're all Europeans. But we're a great part of this too.
Oh, yeah.
We're a great part of this too.
Yeah. You know, before Miles Monroe died, he said the black man had the eyes to the church, and they persecuted him. They persecuted him. Go ahead, Mario.
Just to go back on that, yeah, you know, when you look at the scriptures, it's Negro all through. You know, the Hamitic background, Shemitic.
Yes.
And so you deal with this, and those are all Negro people from the core. Even Adam himself. Adam, Eve, when God made them from the earth, he took the dirt of the earth. And we know what that color that is. He formed a man and a woman. I mean, people say, oh, well, it ain't about color. Well, if it's not about color, then just tell the truth.
Yes.
This Bible is the history book of God's people.
Yes.
And it's telling about the beginning and the things that are going on now and the things to come. And God is wanting his people to keep to stay focused.
Stay focused.
And without a history, you can't stay focused.
Amen.
When things have been stripped from you, you can't. That's what it causes all the confusion in society today.
That's right.
My people don't know who they are.
They don't.
They've lost their footing. They've lost their mind, would you say?
Yeah.
But that started back with Willie Lynch and slavery.
Yes, sir.
And that was prophesied in the Bible. Deuteronomy 28 talks about that.
That talks
so
about that.
So Moses, what did he do? Moses, God told him to put his hands in his bosom. And when he took it out, it said it turned to his other flesh and he was afraid. What, it was leprous white?
Yes, sir.
So it's letting you know that he put it back and it turned back to his regular flesh. This man was a man of color. This is the one who stretched out that rod and the sea parted. This is that same man who delivered the people out.
That's right.
But God is the truth of God is in the word. And if you read, study, get an understanding, you'll be walking up.
You will. Amen. You know, I heard a white man, I don't know if he wanted to say it, and he said Moses was an African man, you know. I guess he got frustrated. He said he was an African man.
Yeah.
And he was. He was.
The Time magazine brought that out.
Yeah.
Adam and Eve.
Adam and Eve.
Talks about the Ethiopian rivers that run through the garden.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve.
Not
Adam and Steve.
Come on there. Adam and Eve.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Well, keeping the Passover, God promised 7 or 8 blessings. One of the blessings that he promised, but he would send an angel before you to guard you. We need angels right now.
Amen.
Wherever you are, wherever you're going, you need an angel. Go to the 12th chapter of Acts, Bro Mario, and I'm going to prove to you what God did for Peter. Now, in that passage of scripture, James had already been beheaded because of his testimony and the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Herod had him killed, had him beheaded. Boy, that's a shame, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the thing about it, they had Peter in jail, prison, and they had 4 quadrants of soldiers getting ready to take him to court to behead him the next day. But God showed up.
Amen.
Read that, Mario.
12 and
1.
Now about the time Herod the king stretched forth his hand to vex certain of the church, and he killed James, the brother of John, and because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also. Then were the days of unleavened bread.
Unleavened bread.
And when he had apprehended him, he put him in prison and delivered him to four quadrants of soldiers to keep him, intending after Easter to bring him forth.
Hold it right there. Go back. Easter, that should be Passover.
Yes, it should.
Go ahead. Okay, go ahead, Mario.
Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him.
Hold it right there. Who made prayer?
The church.
The church. See how important it is, the church? You know why people don't want to go to church? Because there's power there.
Uh-huh.
I'm talking about the body of believers that are praying. He
Amen.
Said the church.
Uh-huh.
You out there, if you saved, you are the church.
Amen.
And it takes endurance in prayer.
Yes,
I mean, it takes some time. It takes sacrifice. And staying in prayer is not an easy thing. It's a discipline part. And this is why it worked with Peter at this time.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead, Mario.
And when Herod would have brought him forth, the same night Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains. And the keepers before the door kept the prison. And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and a light shined in the prison. And he smote Peter on the side and raised him up, saying, arise up quickly. And his chains fell off from his hand.
His what?
His chains fell off from his hand.
And
the angel said unto him, gird thyself and bind on thy sandals. And so did he. And he said unto him, cast thy garments about thee and follow me. And he went out and followed him, and wist not that it was true which was done by the angel, but thought he saw a vision. When they were past the first and the second ward, they came unto the iron gate and led unto the city, which opened them of his own accord.
Mm-hmm.
And they went out and passed on through one street, and forthwith the angel departed from him.
You talking about power and miracles going to happen during this season. See, that's why the devil don't want you to know about this. Y'all that's been going to church for years and years, and you don't know nothing about Passover. Right? Because the devil has lied to you, and some of us ministers, me included, have been uninformed.
Uh-huh.
What does scripture say about the lack of knowledge?
Yeah. Knowledge,
the knowledge of God. Mm-hmm. You know, and because we have no knowledge, then my people perish.
Mm-hmm.
They're destroyed. Some people die prematurely.